till the sea closed opens.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the second installment of the Center for Italian Studies Dante's series to celebrate the septicentenary of Dante's demise. This class, we have a distinguished guest, Professor Jason Houston, who is the dean and professor of Italian at the Gonzaga University in Florence. He customarily teaches Dante and leads the program for Gonzaga University in the Florence campus. He is a full-fledged medievalist. His research focuses on Giovanni Boccaccio and Boccaccio's relationship with the other Italian authors, the crowns or not, Dante, Petrarca, and specifically the Florentine Zanobi da Strada. Professor Houston's publications include numerous articles, edited volumes, more on this in a moment. But his monograph is Building a Monument to Dante, Boccaccio as Dantista, which came out in 2011. He is now preparing, or perhaps you can tell us something about it if it is ready, the translation of Boccaccio's short and Latin works that will come out with Harvard University Press in the fabled Itati Renaissance Library series. And that this work of translation will bring many of Boccaccio's texts into English that were not translated before. So we have Professor Houston today lecturing on Dante between Ulysses and Guido da Montefeltro. And his talk is aptly entitled, Hold Your Tongue. So Professor Houston, if you want, you have the floor.
Thank you so much, Professor Gazzola, or as I know you, Giuseppe, but we'll keep it formal here. It's a real pleasure. And I'm going to share screen now. I'm going to bring up my PowerPoint as I go into the introductory part of my lecture. Let's see if I get this right and put it on. Is that working for everybody? Great, thanks. So thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to speak with you. It's an honor to be invited. Stony Brook is a fantastic university, a fantastic Italian program. And to be able to come to you today from Florence, you know, on Zoom, it really doesn't matter where we are physically. But indeed, I am coming to you from Dante's birth place of Florence, Italy, where despite all the COVID restrictions and everything, the celebration of Dante's 700th year of his death is in full swing. And that's kind of, I want to touch on that a little bit today as I do this talk, because the relationship between Dante and Florence is a difficult one, and it's been difficult for about 700 years or more, let's say about 720 years, and that continues today. So not a big part of my lecture, but a little part will be about Dante and Florence today, because I'm here, because I'm, you know, I think that that's an interesting thing I can offer you to talk about what's going on with Dante today in Florence and this year. But that's not the main part, of course. The main part of this talk is that I want to read Dante with you. There's a lot going on to celebrate Dante's 700th anniversary. Good. I'm glad there is. But in my perspective, from my point of view, the best thing we can do as students, as teachers, as readers, to celebrate Dante is to read him. And so my goal today is not to offer you a brilliant new interpretation of Canto 26 and 27. My goal today is to read Dante with you. And so my lecture, like it is when I teach Dante, and I'm actually not teaching Dante this semester, which is painful because, you know, I love teaching Dante. It's the best thing I do every year of my job. And we don't have students here in Florence, unfortunately, right now. So you guys are giving me a great opportunity to do what I love the best as in my job, in my career, which is to teach Dante to undergraduate students and to read Dante together with undergraduate students. So thank you. Thank you for this invitation and thank you for this opportunity. Just to let you know, I am going to be citing from the Hollander edition of the translation of the Divine Comedy. I don't know which one you're reading. The translations I put on the screen are from the Hollander one. So if you are looking at a translation, it might be slightly different, but I don't think it should affect our work today. So I will bring out a few themes in Canto 26, and then I'll extend those into Canto 27. I think the majority of what we do today will be about Canto 26, because boy, this is one of the best cantos of the Divine Comedy, Canto 26. This is one that everybody knows. And every Italian can read from memory about 9 lines of this canto, O Frati Dissi, these famous 9 lines of Ulysses. So I got a blockbuster canto, so I don't want to give it a short shrift, but I do want to talk about Canto 27 because it reflects upon Canto 26. So we learn more about 26 when we read 27, and I want to do that with you today. As my title suggests, I want to bring out the theme of Dante's reticence, the fact that he's kind of quiet in these two canti. And you've probably read enough Dante to know that he's not afraid to show himself to be quite an egotistical writer, right? Dante's very proud of who he is, and he's very confident in himself. We can think of Canto 5 or Canto 4 of Inferno, where he meets all those great poets, and he includes himself among them. So why is Dante particularly quiet in this canto? Why does he hold his tongue? And it's not just that line, but there's others. So that's one thing I'll explore. I want to understand what this sin is. False counsel? Strange. Strange sin to be so low in hell. So let's get a sense of why that sin is here. I want to look at the figure of Ulysses. He's clearly the highlight of Canto 26 is this character of Ulysses, who we all know from the Homeric epics and beyond. And Dante does some strange things with Ulysses that I want to look at. And I want to show you how Dante sees in Ulysses a typological figure of himself and Adam. So Dante's constructing this typological. There's a medieval term that is a biblical interpretation tool where Old Testament figures predict New Testament figures. So David predicts Christ. That's a typology. Ulysses kind of predicts Dante, and Adam kind of predicts Ulysses. And this connection's tenuous, but it's there. So I want to explore that. And finally, I want to, about 26, I want to point out and talk about the language question. All Canti 26 of the Divine Comedy, the three, Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso, deal with questions of language. Questions of Italian, Latin, Provençal, Greek in the issue at our canto today in 26, and the relationship between the language. So this Canto 26, Dante is really working some questions about language and style that I think we'll talk about as well. And finally, how does Canto 27, the story of Guido da Montefeltro, shed light and reveal something about Canto 26 that we might not notice if we aren't reading closely? Okay. Ulysses is such an important character, by the way, that he's one of the very few personaggi of the Divine Comedy that's mentioned in every canticle. And he's in 26 in Hell, he's mentioned in 27 in Purgatorio, and he's mentioned in 27 in Paradiso. Very few characters. Virgil, Beatrice, Dante, and Boniface, good old Boniface VIII. They're the only other characters that are mentioned in the entirety of the Divine Comedy, in each of the canticles. So Ulysses is a very crucial character. Took this picture a couple nights ago, and this is what I want to start with by showing you a little bit about the funny relationship between Florence and Dante, as we can see in this canto. The beginning of Canto 26 opens up with an invective. Dante steps out of his role as a poet and a pilgrim, and he becomes a political philosopher, better a political pundit. And he says, Take joy, O Florence, for you are so great, your wings beat over land and sea. Your fame resounds through hell. Among the thieves, I found five citizens of yours who make me feel ashamed, and you are raised by them to no great praise. And he goes on. Looking back at Cantos 24 and 25, which were the thieves in the seventh Bolgia, Dante says, Florence, you're so great that hell is full of your citizens. Of course, this is not a compliment, right? He's letting Florence have it for producing sinners. And at this particular moment, here is a restaurant in town, in Florence, that has taken this canto, cut it out of its context, and gives us Godi Fiorenza, the first lines, which sound good for a restaurant. Enjoy Florence. But every Florentine knows what the rest of this phrase is from, is that this is actually lines condemning Florence. So this is an aside, but to show you this kind of love-hate relationship that Florence has with Dante, this kind of playful use of Dante. And in fact, those of you who have been to Florence know that he's plastered everywhere, and he's used to sell product. And so Dante in the 700 year anniversary is continuing to be used in this kind of way. So this is just one little aside I wanted to share with you about Dante's presence in Florence today. And there'll be another one coming up as well. So Dante begins the canto of 26, the opposite of reticent. He begins screaming, right? This invective is a kind of poetic yell, cri de coeur, that opens up this canto, looking back at canto 25 of the thieves and remarking on the presence of Florentines. So it's really offset when we begin the meat of canto 26, and Dante's looking down into the Bolgia, where these flames, he can see these flames, and he gets serious again after this invective, and more subdued. And he tells us, still in the voice of the poet, and these are lines 19 through 24 of Canto 2, that he's gonna pull back as a poet. I grieve then, and now I grieve again, as my thoughts turn to what I saw. And more than is my way, I curb my powers. Ingenio freno. So he's gonna pull back on his poetic powers, he tells us. He's gonna begin to hold his tongue a little bit. It's not going to be as outspoken as he was at the beginning of this canto, so he tells us. Lest they run on where virtue fails to guide them, so that if friendly star or something better still has granted me its boon, I do not misuse the gift. And he's specifically talking about his poetic voice here. And those second three lines may remind you of another point in the Inferno, canto 15, where Brunetto Latini tells Dante, follow your star. And here we have a friendly star, which is his poetic gift. Brunetto Latini tells Dante, become a poet and do that. Well, here Dante's saying, I'm going to pull back on my poetic powers in this canto particularly. So this is set up. Right now, this doesn't really make sense to us. Why? But this is Dante setting himself up for this encounter with Ulysses, where his poetic power, so to speak, is going to be subdued, pulled down, and Virgil's is going to be elevated above him. So he's setting up this dynamic in poetic style, and he's saying, I'm pulling my style back. Now, after he says this, immediately after he says this, what does Dante do? I'm not going to read these because they're long, but canto about lines 25 through, not 420, that would be really long. Canto 25, lines 25 through 42 are two stacked epic similes. So Dante the poet's looking at, and the pilgrims looking on this vision of these flames and this Bolgia, and he compares them to two different things through similes, right? Through the so to just like similes, but not just your normal simile that lasts two lines. These are epic similes, each of which lasts three terzine, or nine lines. These are classical epic similes. These are things Homer does. If you ever read Homer or Virgil, if you have, there are these long similes he compares things to that last forever and ever. So Dante's purposely inserting these epic similes, which are not common in the Divine Comedy. Similes are, but epic ones are not as. Right after he said, I'm going to stop poeting so much. And then what's he do? He poets a lot by giving us two epic similes right after that. So what I have in front of you now is a portrait of Dante in the Duomo in Florence, another aside for Florence, painted by Domenico di Michelino in the 15th century. Why I put this up here is because it's a pretty image, but also it shows us the Dante that we're seeing at this moment in this canto. Dante who lets his poem speak. The Dante image here is second to the book he's holding and the poetic verses he's showing. And you see that little, you can hard to see, but on the left side of his book towards the city of Florence are rays of light. Because this painting is called Dante e la Commedia illumina la città di Firenze. The comedy enlightens the city of Florence. It's the poetry that speaks in Canto 26, not the pilgrim, not the poet. I know that's it's a fine distinction, but Dante's making it here. He's saying, I'm going to pull back my style, I'm going to let, and my own voice, but I'm going to let my poetry speak. And so this reticence that we're seeing coming out of here is kind of a false reticence, because Dante's saying, as a pilgrim and as a first-person speaker, I'm going to pull back, but my poetry is going to give the message that this canto needs to pass on to you. By the way, those two epic similes are a common thing that Dante does. One of them is a kind of classical one where he compares naturalistic. So he compares the flames in the Bolgia, which are become the speakers, to fireflies. So it's a natural scene. The second one's a biblical simile where he compares that to Elijah in the Book of Kings, the prophet who ascends to heaven on flames. So as Dante does often in a scholastic way, he brings together a pagan and a Christian simile to create a duality. And that's going to be another theme that we come out in this canto, is the kind of difference between the pagan hero of Ulysses and the Christian anti-hero of Guido de Montefeltro, who will come up next. So here we get to the scene that's part of the citation that leads my lecture and is the title of my lecture. This idea of holding your tongue. And what happens? So Dante sees in the ditch of the Bolgia that these flames are actually people. And he's curious. And he's not quite sure yet who's there. So he asks Virgil. Now, I don't want to read the whole thing, but there's parts of it I want to read, but I don't have up here. So Canto 26, if you're following along, on line 55, Virgil tells him that in one of those flames are two sinners. Within this flame, find torment Ulysses and Diomedes. They are paired in God's revenge, as once they earned his wrath. In their flame they mourn the stratagem of the horse that made a gateway through which the noble seed of Rome came forth. There they lament the wiles for which in death Deidamia mourns Achilles still. And there they make amends for the Palladium. So Virgil tells us who they are, Ulysses and Diomedes, characters from the Homeric epic, the Iliad and the Odyssey. And also Virgil wrote about them. And he tells us what they did. The Trojan horse, we all know the famous story of the Trojan horse. The fact that Achilles was fooled to come back by Ulysses to the battle of Troy. And therefore he left his bride on the island and never saw her again, he dies. And finally, the theft of the Palladium, which is something that Diomedes did, is a painting of Athena in Troy that the Greeks stole. And then they said the Trojan horse was a gift to make up for the stealing of the Palladium. So these are war tactics that were false, that were lies. So here we get a sense of what the sin is. But I don't want to focus on that right now. I want to focus on this character of Ulysses. Because when Dante hears that a Ulysses is there, he's like, Mike, I got to talk to him. And he in praise, he says, La tua preghiera, Virgil says here. He really asks Virgil, can we go talk to him? Please, 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 can we talk to them? Now, you've read enough Dante to know that when Dante wants to talk to someone, he gets down in it. And that is when some interesting stuff happens. Like when he wants to talk to Francesca and Paolo, right? Interesting stuff happens. When he's less interested, let's say like Canto 12, he's not interested in those tyrants. He doesn't talk to him. He just kind of passes by. But Dante the poet is interested, so Dante the pilgrim is going to talk to them. But Virgil cautions him. And here are the lines that you have on the screen now, lines 70 to 75. He says, sure, you can talk to them, but, and he to me, your prayer deserves much praise to speak with him. Therefore, I grant it, but on the condition that you hold your tongue. Leave speech to me, for I have understood just what you want. And since they were Greeks, they might disdain your words. Hold your tongue. Again, another, the moment of reticence that is imposed on Dante. You may remember, I don't know if you guys read, if you just came off reading Canto 25. What did Dante say in Canto 25 to two poets? Taccia Ovidio, taccia Lucano. Hold your tongue, Ovid. Hold your tongue, Lucan. Because my poetry is better than yours. So just one canto earlier than this, Dante had told Latin poets, shut up, taccia, be quiet. Here a Latin poet is telling Dante, be quiet. And this is something that I loved about Dante. He does this often. He always corrects himself. Canto 4, my poetry is as good as Homer's. Look at me, I'm with the Homer Virgil crowd. Remember that in Limbo? What happens to Canto 5? Oh my God, my poetry's killing people. Faints and dies. Doesn't really die, but Dante realizes that his poetry has led Francesca to sin. So he corrects himself. Here's another episode of that. Canto 25, he says, all these transformations I see here were better than Ovid's transformations in the Metamorphoses, were better than Lucan's transformations in the Pharsalia. So I'm going to tell them, hold their tongue. Taccia Ovidio, taccia Lucano. And then he turns the tables on himself in Canto 26. Why does Virgil tell him to be quiet? Here it's because he's Greek. That's the reason he gives. What does that mean? I always thought, and it seems rational that Virgil and Ulysses are going to chat in Greek. You think Ulysses speaks Italian? Unlikely. Virgil probably spoke Greek and Latin for sure. So I think we're supposed to believe that these guys are speaking in Greek. But as we now move to what Virgil says, and I'm going to skip over some stuff just reading it. There's a long bit here. I can't read all of it. We notice that he actually doesn't, it's not just about what language they're speaking, but the tone. And so here's what Virgil says to Ulysses after this. Oh, you who are, and this is line 79. Virgil says to Ulysses, oh, you who are twinned within a single fire, if I have earned your favor while I live, if I have earned your favor in whatever measure, when in the world I wrote my lofty verses, then do not move away. Let one of you relate just where, having lost his ways, he went to die. The classic capitatio benevolentiae, rhetorical term of tell people how great they are, they'll be good back to you. And anaphora, if I have earned your favor, if I have earned your favor. These are high style rhetorical tools. So it's not just perhaps that they're speaking a different language. It's also that Virgil, tragic poet, epic poet of the Aeneid, speaks to Ulysses, tragic character, tragic epic poetry of Homer and of the Iliad and the Odyssey. What is Dante's poem called? The Commedia, or the Commedia, the comic poet. So there's a style problem here that Dante is pointing out. I write my poetry. I'm going to Frenare. I'm going to put on the brakes of my poetry, my comedic poetry, because this is a canto of tragic poetry, of epic poetry, of high poetry. Everything about Ulysses is great. He's a hero. So we're getting some interesting signals here at the poem in Canto 26. Dante's going to be quiet. He's going to give up the style of his poem and kind of lend it to Virgil, this canto, and let Virgil do the speaking. Apparently, there's a language question as well between Greek and Italian, or the Florentine dialect, let's say. Let's now go to the speech that Ulysses gives, which is, again, one of the most famous parts of the entirety of the Divine Comedy, is this speech that Ulysses gives. It's long, so I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'm going to read with you closely the speech within a speech. I'm going to read to you now, and I've highlighted some lines here that I'll touch upon. But this is such a great speech that I think it's worthwhile that we hear it. So line 90, Ulysses starts and tells his story, which is an extension of the Homeric Ulysses story that comes through in the Odysseus, in the Odyssey. So the Odyssey ends, and where Odyssey ends, Ulysses is back in Attica, back with Penelope, everything's good. This story picks up, and Ulysses leaves again. When I, line 90, took leave of Circe, who for a year and more beguiled me there, not far from Gaeta, before Aeneas gave it that name. So here's another exchange. Apparently, Ulysses has read the Aeneid. Even though the Aeneid was written 1,000 years after Ulysses, not 1,000 years, 500 years after Ulysses would have died, right? That Aeneas gave his name to Rome and to the Italic peninsula happens after Ulysses would have known. So there's an exchange here of mutual satisfaction between Ulysses and Virgil. Oh, I know your poem. Okay, just another aside there. Not tenderness for a son, nor filial duty, classical virtues that don't apply to Ulysses, apparently, right? It says, these things I should have done. Tenderness for a son, filial duty toward my father, nor the love I owed Penelope that would have made her glad, could overcome the fervor I had to gain experience of the world and learn about man's vices and worth. Here we start to hear some Adamic language. Ulysses' quest for knowledge, his quest for vice and virtue, the tree in the garden, Adam's interest in the forbidden fruit for knowledge. So here's where Dante's starting to draw a parallel between Ulysses and Adam. And so I set forth on the open deep with but a single ship and that handful of shipmates who had not deserted me. On one shore and the other, I saw as far as Spain, Morocco, on the Isle of Sardinia, and other islands into the sea. So you see him, he's cruising along the Mediterranean from east to west, right? Heading towards Spain from Greece. I and my shipmates had grown old and slow by the time we reached the narrow straits where Hercules marked off the limits. The Seignon de Hercules, the Pillars of Hercules, which is the Rock of Gibraltar. Now, I've given you a mapa mondo here, a medieval map, and you probably won't see it that well, but I'll highlight it here with my arrow right here. Here's Spain, here's North Africa on this map, and here's the route of Ulysses to the Mediterranean, and here's the open sea. The Seignon of Hercules are where supposedly Hercules put these pillars to say man should not travel beyond. Here's what he says. Where Hercules marked off the limits, line 109, warning all men to go no further. On the right-hand side, I left behind Seville. On the other, Ceuta, North Africa. By the way, another aside, if you'll permit me, as you listen to this journey, think of this as a flat world that Dante's describing through Ulysses' words. Oh, brothers, I said, who in the course of 100, let me go to the next line here. So this is the speech, within a speech, that Ulysses gives to encourage his men to go beyond the limits, right? He just told us we were passing through the Straits of Gibraltar, the Pillars of Hercules, where the gods have told us not to go. And my men didn't want to go, potentially. He doesn't say that, but that's the idea. They need more encouragement. So he gives the speech of all speeches. I'm going to play for you the most important moment in the Olympic opening ceremony of the 2006 Olympics in Turin. How many of you've probably all seen opening ceremonies of the Olympics before? They're incredibly gaudy performance art that lasts like 5 hours, right? But it's a nation showing itself to the world and saying who we are. Millions and millions, if not billions of people are watching the opening ceremony. It's a chance for the nation to say, this is what we are. How do the, and this moment I'm about to show you is right after the Parade of Nations. So you know that boring thing where every country sends every athlete in to the Olympics and lasts for like 2 hours. And then after that, the real thing begins. That's this. The Parade of Nations has just ended. And the ceremony part, the choreography, Italy showing itself to the world begins. And we're not in Tuscany here. We're in Piedmont. So we're not in Florence.
Frati, dissi che per 100.000 perigli siete giunti all'Occidente, a questa tanto piccola vigilia dei nostri sensi, che è del rimanente, non vogliate negar l'esperienza di retro al sol del mondo senza gente, considerate la vostra semenza. Fatti non foste a viver come bruti, ma per seguir virtute e conoscenza.
All right, so in this moment of profound nation building and nation self-sharing, Italy chooses this speech of Ulysses that he just read and you see here. Oh, brothers. I said, who in the course, I've got my thing blocked, I'll read it from a book. Oh, brothers, I said, who in the course of 100,000 perils at last have reached the West to such brief wakefulness of our senses as remains to us, do not deny yourselves the chance to know, following the sun, the world where no one lives. Consider how your souls were sown. You are not made to live like brutes and beasts, but to pursue virtue and knowledge. The heroic speech of the epic hero. And what does it lead to? Go ahead. Let's see. It leads to the death of all the people on the ship and their eternal condemnation to hell. This is the kind of paradox of the Ulysses Canto. He's such a heroic figure that he stands in out of context, like Godi Firenze on that restaurant in Florence, which is actually an insult to Florence, but is being used to sell cornetti and scacciata. Here, the Ulysses speech becomes the signal moment of Italy showing itself to the world as this great place of virtue and knowledge. But what does Dante mean it as? A speech that leads to eternal damnation for the person who said it and the people who heard it. Now, I put this picture up here because it's another one I really like. This is Bronzino's portrait of Dante. You can see he's holding the Divine Comedy. Florence is on his left here under his hand. Purgatorio's out there. And look at that little ship under his elbow. Whose ship do you think that is? I don't know. I have another. I have actually a different idea, but it could be Ulysses' ship heading out to Purgatorio, heading out beyond the Pillars of Hercules to find new things, to see the world. Well, as I ask, what happens to that ship? With this brief speech, I had my companions so ardent for the journey, I could scarce have held them back. And having set out on our stern to sunrise, in our mad flight, we turned our oars to wings, always gaining on the left. Ship is heading west and south. And for 5 months, the ship goes west and south. Does that sound like a flat world to you? I don't know if you've already disabused them of this notion, Professor Gazzola, but nobody in the Middle Ages ever thought the world was flat. The world was always round, except now some people think the world's flat, apparently. But this idea that the Middle Ages thought the world was flat was created in the 19th century. So here we have Dante taking our Ulysses out beyond the Pillars of Hercules to the west and south for 5 months of voyage. Notice that language of a mad flight. Again, this is language that we will remember or we will see again when we meet Adam. Folle volo. And we also saw it with Geryon in Canto 16. The descent he described as a mad flight as well. Reminding Dante and the reader of Dante's poem is taking the same journey. Dante's own poem is a bit of a mad flight. And how I can get you here on that is this: from oars to wings. This Reme facemmo ali, which translates from Latin remigium alarum. You probably don't have to write that down. I'm sure Professor Gotzola will not test you on this, which comes from Virgil. But the point being, remigium alarum, oars like wings, is literally the encyclopedic definition of poetic metaphor in the Middle Ages. Hugh of St. Victor, who wrote this thing called the Didascalicon, which is a book of how to poet and other things, had entries about different rhetorical figures. And when he said, what is a metaphor? This is the example he used. So this is the fundamental poetic metaphor of transgression, of language, of poetry, stretching beyond its natural bounds, which is exactly what Ulysses is trying to do. And we're all for him, right? Go, Ulysses, go. Virtue and knowledge, go get it. And Dante's saying, my poem's also doing this, but what's the difference? Why is Dante's poem working, Ulysses doesn't? So where does this voyage take Ulysses? When we could see a mountain distance and distant, dark and dim, in my sight it seemed higher than any I'd ever seen. So this voyage is bringing Ulysses and his crew to see Mount Purgatorio, which is, as you will discover soon, is on the opposite pole of the world from Jerusalem. So the round world that they live on, the bottom of the round world, the southern hemisphere, what we consider the southern Arctic zone, what we call Antarctica, is Purgatorio in Dante's imagination. We rejoice, but joy soon turned to grief for from that unknown land there came a whirlwind that struck the ship head on. 3 times it turned her, and all the waters with her. And the fourth our stern reared up, the prow went down, as pleased another, until the sea closed over us. I think that number 3 in there is random. Is anything random in the Divine Comedy? A poem that Dante took 17 years to write?
Well, usually, I'm so sorry to interrupt. I just you know, the holy number is three, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
You were interrupted perfectly. You're doing my work for me. But Ulysses still doesn't get it. As pleased another. Here we have Ulysses in hell, suffering in hell, and he still doesn't recognize his limits. And he still doesn't recognize God, the Christian God. He doesn't name him. He specifically unnames it. Come a tui piacque. But the signs are there. 1, 2, 3. You got it right on. So Ulysses' voyage is not allowed. It was clearly not allowed, but he stretches beyond and he brings himself with his words, his prolixity. He's talking this whole canto. Dante's not. That's what that reticence. Dante is protecting himself as the poet. Why is he protecting himself? Because he's guilty of this too. Dante is stretching the limits of his poetry. Who gets to write about heaven, hell, and who goes there? Who knows that? Nobody knows that. Dante's trying to convince us that he knows that. So he's going beyond where he's supposed to go as a poet as well. And so that's part of his the reason I think he's so reticent in these cantos, is because he knows he's kind of like Ulysses. And as you discover when you see Dante in Canto 26 of Purgatorio, if you read that canto, if you want to have me back, I'll talk about it. He meets another poet who's another figure like him, a guy named Guido Guinicelli. And guess what they talk about? Poetic language. And then when in Canto 26 of Paradiso, he meets Adam. So there's more connection. Guess what they talk about? Guess what Dante's most interesting and important question to Adam is? What language did you write in? Or did you speak? Because Adam, for Dante, is the first poet. Because he goes on naming things, creating language, creating metaphor through his acts of naming. He wants to know what that language was. The same language question that we have here, style and language. Dante doesn't use his language to speak with Ulysses. He lets Virgil do it because he knows that it's this language is dangerous, and he wants no part of it. Let's move to 27, where I think I can help clear up some of the things that might be confusing. Maybe there's a lot that's confusing, but hopefully I can clear some things up. Because, in fact, Canto 27 does clear up some stuff for us in a way that we probably weren't expecting about Canto 26. Just to set the stage, we aren't going anywhere. This is one of the few places, no, not one of the few, actually many of the Bolgi, we spend more than one canto in here. We spend two canti in the Bolgi of False Counselors. So we haven't moved. Ulysses and Diomedes move on. And then another flame comes up, and this time it's a flame with only one person in it. And Virgil looks at this guy and says, and here we have lines 19 to 21, Virgil says, when this flame starts to talk and ask who they are, Virgil says, we heard it say, oh, you at whom I aim my voice and who just now, no, sorry, this isn't Virgil, this is the flame speaking. I apologize, Virgil speaks later. So the flame comes up to them and approaches them and starts talking. And the flame says, oh, you at whom I aim my voice and who just now said in the Lombard tongue, now go your way, I ask you nothing more. What do we learn from this encounter? We learn that what language were Virgil and Ulysses speaking in? They weren't speaking in Greek. They weren't even speaking in what Dante would consider good Italian. They were speaking in a dialect of Italian that Dante, earlier in another work, didn't like at all, the Lombard dialect. So Guido de Montefeltro tells us, I heard you guys talking with that other flame in Lombard dialect, which means, you know, Northern Italy, Mantua, Milan, that area. So he retroactively tells us that the question about speech between Ulysses and Dante and Virgil wasn't about speaking in Greek or Latin versus Italian. It was about only about style. Because not only is this dialect that we have here in Italian, now I'll try to read in Italian, but Professor Gazzola could do it so better, because he's actually kind of from the north as well, although not Lombardy. But o tu a cui udizzo la voce che parlavi mo lombardo. Questo, that word mo is a dialect and an informal dialect word. It's like, I don't know what we compare it to in English. It's a colloquialism. It's bad Italian even. Dicendo istra tem va più non te dizzo, another Lombard dialect. So we retroactively learned that these two, that Virgil was speaking to Greek in really bad Italian, which makes no sense historically, but disabuses us of the notion that the question was about Greek versus Italian. The question was only about tragic style versus comedic style, and about the dangers of tragic poetry and Ulysses' vision and Dante's own desire to stay clear and free of that. So who is this fellow? This is Guido di Montefeltro. And this is where Virgil says to Dante, after he realizes that this guy is some Italian guy from Dante's own time, a political philosopher advisor, well known for being a trickster. He says, you can speak to him. He speaks Italian. Kind of like saying, I don't care about this guy because he speaks Italian, but also because he's not a classical epic figure. He's just some guy from Dante's own day. So what I want to pull out of the Guido story, and I don't have that much, so I'll go pretty quick. I've got about 5 minutes here, is that what Guido shows us is the powers that this sin of fraudulent counsel have, not only at deluding others, leading others astray. When we think of false counsel, we think it's a sin of leading others astray, right? I'm going to give you advice that's bad advice on purpose. I'm going to use advice or bad counsel to effect a nefarious end, like the storming of Troy, the kind of cheating in military tactics. But here, when Guido di Montefeltro agrees to talk to Dante, Dante identifies who he is, and Guido says, I will only speak to you because what I'm going to tell you is going to bring me dishonor. But if I but thought, I've got to get to my words here. Line 61 through 66 of Canto 27. Guido di Montefeltro responds to Dante saying, if I but thought that my response were made to one perhaps returning to the world, this tongue of flame would cease to flicker. Reticence, right? I would hold my tongue if I thought you were going to go back to the world. But since up from these depths, no one has yet returned alive, if what I hear is true, I answer without fear of being shamed. But since, nobody's ever come out of hell, duh, who can name someone that's come out of hell?
Christ,
there's one. Aeneas, there's another. Orpheus, there's another. Paul, there's another. There are a number of people that have gone to hell and come back. But Guido di Montefeltro doesn't want to hear it. He's in self-delusion. He's fooling himself. So the sin of false counsel, as Guido is showing us here, and Dante's showing us through Guido, is not only sin aimed at others, but it is sin of the self. You're fooling yourself as well. Ulysses was fooling himself to think that his mission was about virtue and knowledge. His mission was about trespassing, was about going beyond where he's supposed to, just like Adam's was. These lines are so powerful that T.S. Eliot used them as the epigraph of his very famous and very readable poem. I recommend it to all of you tonight, The Love Story of J. Alfred Prufrock. Beautiful poem about regret and self-delusion, how people fool themselves. And this lovely poem talks about a man's life, and at each stage of his life, how he looks back and says, and convinces himself that what happened didn't happen because it was his fault, and that he's separate from it. And that sense of reflection and self-delusion is what Guido's showing us. So who is, quickly, I'll just come through this. He shares a lot of things with Guido. Cunning strategies, covert schemes. What did Guido do? Guido was a political counselor. Guido decided at the end of his career of being a bad guy to trade in that job to become a priest or a Franciscan monk, thinking that, hey, if I do this, I'll go to heaven. Because I'm going to, okay, I've lived a life that was really bad. I led a bunch of people astray. But now I'm going to become a Franciscan monk, and it will probably work. But what happens? So look at the lands I've cited here. Cunning stratagems, covert schemes. Those remind us of Ulysses' stratagems. Lowering a sail and coiling up the ropes. That's a ship metaphor, which reminds us again of Ulysses' journey. So there's a lot of parallels between Guido and Ulysses. But the final part of his story is that he's about to die. He's old. And the Pope, Boniface VIII, who you've met before in Canto 19, and you'll meet again, he is Dante's arch enemy. So he's kind of the absent second person in this flame. Comes to Guido while he's repentant and says, I need you to do one more thing. I need you to give me another stratagem to win a battle I'm fighting, which is, we won't get into the details of that. So Guido says, okay, I don't want to do that. I've just, you know, done all my sins. I've done all my penitence. I don't want to go back there. And Boniface says, don't worry about it. I'm the Pope. Let me go back. And he says, I absolve you here and now. This is the third line of what you will teach me to do. So the Pope says, I'm the Pope. I'm going to forgive you of your sin before you even do it. So come here. You're forgiven of your sin. Now tell me the sin. Now do more false counsel. And I said, Father, since you cleanse me of the sin that I must now even commit, promising much with scant observance will seal your trumpet, your triumph on the holy throne. So he says, okay, here's what you do. You go promise a town that to get into a war, and you promise them that you'll send troops, but then when they get into the war, don't send the troops. And then they'll lose the war, then you get the town.
It's horrible.
Horrible. And this is Pope Boniface is taking the advice and asking for it and absolving him of the sin before he does it. Promising much with scant observance. That's the sin that Guido tells Boniface to do. And that's also the sin that Boniface does to Guido, because Guido lets himself get fooled because he, this self-delusion. What happens when Guido dies? Because he thinks, hey, I was absolved of the sin before I even did it. The moment I was dead, Francis came for me, because he became a Franciscan monk. St. Francis came for me. But one of the dark cherubim cried out, no, wrong me not by bearing that one off. He must come down to serve among my minions, because he gave that fraudulent advice. From then till now, I've dogged his footsteps. One man may not be absolved without repentance, nor repent and wish to sin concurrently. A simple contradiction not allowed. And then he goes on to say, maybe you didn't know that devils were logicians as well. So he tells Guido, you can't repent for a sin that you haven't committed yet. That doesn't make sense. So I'm going to take you away and take you down to hell. So Guido's fooled by Boniface, but he's also fooled by himself. And he's continuing to be fooled in hell, because he's telling us this story, which I propose to you is completely made up. Well, the whole thing's made up. But St. Francis wouldn't make this mistake. You think St. Francis up in heaven said, oh, there's one of mine. He knows. People in heaven don't make mistakes. So Guido's continuing to lie, even in death. And I'll finish now, because I'm at the end of my time. But one thing that I want you to remember as you continue reading Inferno, or reflect back on, that I think this episode doesn't really show well, but I've tried to show you, is that the sinners in hell's punishment is the sin itself. That's the brilliance of Dante's Contrapasso system that you'll see in the next canto, 28. It's defined. The punishments are a manifestation of the act that got them there. They're continuing to sin in a way that shows the sin. Think of Francesca blowing in the winds of passion. The winds of passion become real winds of passion. Ulysses still refuses to accept the truth of what happened to him. Come altrui piacque, as another one pleased. I don't know whose fault it was. I don't know who made me drown. You're in hell, dude. You got to understand by now. You made a mistake. Guido, same deal. I don't know why he didn't. You know, Francis even thought I was going to be saved. No, he didn't. You're making it up, Guido. You're continuing to fool yourself and allow yourself to be fooled. Okay, I think I should stop there. There's obviously much more to say, but if there's some time for questions, I have plenty of time.
Yes, indeed. We do have time for questions.
And I'll stop sharing screen here so that you can.
Yes. Thank you. So, well, first of all, I would like to applaud your very rich and very interesting lecture. You like to call it a lectura, but I think it was more than a lectura. In fact, or perhaps a very refined one. I myself had never thought about the fact that Guido is lying when he recounts about St. Francis. But yes, no, of course it is. Of course he is, but I just never, thank you. So that was illuminating to me. And I will want to open the floor to other voices more interesting than mine. But if you don't mind, I will just break the ice while I ask all those who are interested in asking a question to Professor Houston to perhaps start writing it on the chat. So I was thinking from the very beginning, from the introduction of what you explained to us, of the link between, or the setup, as you called it, between Brunetto Latini's story and Ulysses' story, because the cantos are obviously about the boundaries of poetry and about the effects of poetry. On canto 15, Brunetto says to Dante, follow your star and you won't be able to fail. And we have analyzed this in class as a way of that Dante the poet has to have the reader understand how Brunetto still does not understand. But we are also complicating this because there are moments in which even, say, Virgil does not understand. I won't say Dante the Pilgrim. Dante the Pilgrim rarely understands, at least not yet. But even Virgil does not understand. And in fact, he's with Brunetto, when Dante kind of rebukes him covertly, Virgil says, bene ascolta chi la nota, right? So he lauds Dante because of his judgment of Brunetto's false counseling, if you will, right? And so Dante is told to follow his star by Brunetto. Ulysses is following his own direction, and Dante the poet is telling us, not so covertly, that he's following a wrong direction, because he tells us that he's going left, which is a way of saying that he's not going right. Mm-hmm. And of course, it ends how it does. And of course, there is a double reflection to Dante's The Pilgrim's own story, because Dante has already failed his own attempt to gain earthly paradise, as well as Ulysses is right now. He's telling us what is going to happen, right? But the question in all this is that while Virgil is saying bene ascolta chi la nota, so you did good, my friend Dante, in rebuking and understand framing Brunetto's lies, mm-hmm. but he's not saying the same thing when Dante shows interest in understanding or in knowing, getting to know Ulysses' lies. Like, his speech is in fact a lie and he couldn't be otherwise. But Virgil seems to be on board, sorry for the metaphor.
Perfect.
Virgil seems to be on board with that, right? So perhaps it's a way of saying, perhaps, I don't want to answer my own question, but perhaps suggest a path, that Virgil, with all his rationalizing, still is not able to understand completely God's will. Virgil is failing too in his role as a guide at times.
Now, let me say that the response I'm going to give to you is not necessarily my own. And I think everyone in this conversation probably should understand that my reading depended on many scholars' wisdom, but this isn't the place for me to cite a bunch of people and tell you that I got this from this guy and this guy and this woman gave me this reading. But I think the most compelling, and that's, and I hadn't thought it in that way, that Virgil's kind of enthusiasm for the relationship with Ulysses marks a failure of him as a guide. I think it does, and I hadn't thought of that. The way that I see it framing, and I not just myself but others, I think is that it's Dante the poet, and you know, back to his reticence, marking the difference between styles. Just like the epic style of Virgil's Aeneid is my father. It created me as a poet, but that's not what I'm going to do. That's not what I can write. And I think that going back to the Brunetto story is great, because what's the problem between Virgil and Brunetto and Dante? It's a paternity question. It's a paternity lawsuit. It's a paternity battle. It's Dante telling us, who's my poetic father? Because Brunetto's not his friend. He's his father. He's a father figure. And then he's no longer a father figure because Virgil becomes his father figure. So I think what's happening here in response to your question, this failure of Virgil's to get the problem that Ulysses gives us, and then if translated to 27, his refusal to even care about Guido de Montefeltro, right? He's this Christian side of the story I'm not even going to listen to. Reflects Dante the poet saying, I'm writing comedy, that's tragedy. I'm writing this kind of dream vision medieval poem that's more about the individual, it's more autobiographical, it's more lyrical. Dante's comedy is a different kind of poem, but it has parts of the epic style in it. It's length, it's covering an immense subject, but he's saying, I'm going to do a different thing, and I'm going to Our shared teacher, Giuseppe Mazzotta, said, you become your own person when you kill your advisor. Like, when you stab your advisor in the back, the person that you worked on your PhD dissertation, not literally, but in taking distance from them, is when you become your own scholar. And so let's apply that back to Virgil and say, when Dante starts to take that distance, that I think you're right to note that he's taking here. He's starting to say, okay, I've got to start moving away from being a follower of Virgil and delineate my own style, which is the comedic style, which is something different. Is that something that makes sense to you?
Thank you. Thank you much. We have bibliography question from Anna. Anna, if you want to take the floor.
I'm sorry. First of all, thank you so much, Professor. That was so interesting. Can you repeat the name of that poem that you had asked us if we wanted to read it?
Yeah.
Alfred.
T.S. Eliot. Oh, I can write it. I can write it in the chat. T.S. Eliot, The Love Story, The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock. It's, you know, 150 verses, very readable. It's a beautiful poem. It's one of the best high modernist poems ever written. And it's got Dante, so what else do you want?
Got everything. Thank you so much.
It's got everything, right.
And very influential, and it opened a whole literally challenge to Italian poets to actually use Dante in a modernist way.
I'm sure Montale probably enjoyed that poem very much.
I wouldn't want to mention, but
I'll do it for you.
But yes, indeed. So yes, thank you. I think it is a crucial passage in Dante's interpretation in the 20th century, absolutely.
And we have to say, I mean, there's a whole story here we're not telling, but this is part of it, is that, so as I mentioned this, that, so Homer creates the character of Ulysses, Odysseus, Ulysses, same character, right? And he's both a very important, crucial character in the Iliad, and then he's the main protagonist he's almost the antagonist kind of in the Iliad, and he's the protagonist in the Odyssey. Then Virgil takes that character and develops it even further. So Ulysses is now the Latin version that appears in the Aeneid, and he takes the story further. And then what's Dante do? He takes the story again and expands it. And then Alfred Lord Tennyson, a British poet from the 19th century, takes the story even further in a poem he writes called Ulysses. I think that's what I remember the title. And then what we have here is this further development of T.S. Eliot saying, I'm going to be a little tricky here and take something from the next canto and give that another life as well, which then Montale takes, and then it probably goes on from there. So this is how literary canons are. And let's read outside of the canon, everybody. Let's all read literature from all over the world, from all of the different people. But I love literature of all types. But let's talk also about the canon and how it happens. And this is how it happens. Are poets stealing from each other and then stabbing each other in the back? That's maybe I've been living in Italy too long and studying Machiavelli. But it's the kind of the poets that they steal from each other and then try to one up each other. And that's what Dante's doing here. That's how Dante's writing himself into the canon of literature. Well, he did in Canto 4, pretty obviously, but he's doing it here more effectively by carrying on the Ulysses story.
Thank you. Ashley, would you like to take the floor?
Yeah, sure. So I just wanted to say thank you for the presentation. And my question is basically, when you were talking about the way Guido like was saying that the Pope can forgive someone for their sin, I just found that powerful, how he was like kind of saying like, oh, the Pope can be God. Like, would it be right to say that he's making a parallel between Pope and God, like saying that, oh, the Pope can be all so powerful? And also, I just wanted to say, I like that you emphasized how you must commit the sin first in order to repent, because I just found that interesting from the story.
Here's I think what he's doing with the Pope in the Guido story, and he's actually taking some power away from the Pope, because the story that Guido tells is that, hey, the Pope came to me, and everybody knows the Pope has the keys that unlock and lock the gates of heaven, and that's even in the text. But what Dante's saying, and this is where Dante gets in trouble. And, you know, I've looked at manuscripts of the Divine Comedy that were redacted by the Inquisition. So the Divine Comedy was never banned. There's the Index of Banned Book that's famous that a lot of, you know, people talk about. Oh, the church banned all these books. They certainly did. They never banned the Divine Comedy, but they went in with a black pen and crossed out certain lines they didn't like. And these lines were often taken out because they're reducing the Pope's power. They're saying, if the Pope promises you something that is not logical, and here's the logical problem, the only way to be done with a sin in Christian theology is to repent for the sin. You can do 27 Hail Marys, you can go to communion, you can, you know, say 72 acts of contrition, whatever they tell you in the booth, you could do that. But if you truly haven't repented of the sin, because sin is all about intentionality, and that's also at the heart of the Divine Comedy as well, that of hell. It's not about the effect of the sin, it's about the intention of the sinner is the depth of the sin. That's why murder is so high. You know, murder's not as bad as this. That doesn't make sense to us. Anyways, it's the side. But he's taking power away from the Pope. He's saying, you can't forgive a sin that hasn't been committed. Even you, Pope, don't have that power. So there are times when Dante stretches the limit of what we might call orthodoxy in the Middle Ages. They're not a lot. But this one is on the bounds of kind of political orthodoxy, because he's saying to the Pope, who is not the actual Pope when he's writing this, but was maybe the Pope 3 years before, which is really scandalous. Pope, you were wrong. And so that's actually trying to take away power from the papacy.
And not any pope, but a very specific one. We know something about him, don't we?
You've seen him, Canto 19. But, oh, you haven't seen
well,
him.
Well, not quite, but he was announced.
Yeah, yes. He's announced. And I actually think he's announced here as well. I think that there's the duality between Ulysses and Diomedes. There's a figura mancante, right, and it's Boniface, right? They
but
should
this
be
is the, this is a problem in the order of hell, because why is Boniface condemned for the lighter sin when he is obviously a fraudulent counselor, just as well as Guido is, right?
I was thinking about this last night, Giuseppe. Actually, I was thinking about this exact question. Why isn't Boniface here? And I was also thinking about this in terms of Guido's fake story about St. Francis. Who tells us that Boniface is going to be in Canto 19?
Ooh, brilliant.
A pope tells us.
Brilliant.
The same pope who tells us, you know, I can't really see, or is it, no, it's in Canto 6 where they tell us we can't really see what's happening right now. We can only see what's way before and way after.
Right.
So why do we believe Nicholas III that he's coming?
Di molt'anni mi menti lo scritto, but he's quoting. But yes, I see
it,
your
it just
point.
Came to my mind. You know, maybe Boniface is going to have time in all parts of hell. I think Dante would make an exception for him.
Well, thank you. Actually, this is really interesting. Philip, would you like to take the floor?
Sure. My question is more of a generic one. I'm just curious as to what inspired you to study or to specialize in the medieval period of Italian authors and Italian literature.
That's great. Thank you for asking. And you know, are you all Italian majors or minors? I would imagine a number of you are, I hope. Do the major in Italian. I don't have the benefit, like a lot of you do, of being Italian American. There's not a drop of Italian blood, which is a pain because I'd like to become a citizen of Italy, and it's hard. I'm going to give you the cheesiest answer that's actually true. Reading Dante, I you might think I'm making that up, but I absolutely am not. I'm not. When I was a junior in high school, we had to do a project for our English class. You know, English literature class. And I chose Dante because the cover of the edition, which was you can look at it online, the Dorothy Sayers translation, was a hellscape. So it had all these demons poking people. And maybe, I played Dungeons and Dragons back then, so I like demons poking people. And it said comedy on it. I said, it's funny, and there's demons poking people. This is great. I'm going to read this book. So I was a bit disappointed because it's not very funny, except for the fart joke in Canto 21. But did your professor show you the fart joke? I hope he did.
We'll go over it. We haven't.
Okay, go back and read the end of Canto 21. There's a great fart joke. But reading Dante inspired me to want to go to Italy and study the Middle Ages. And then when I came here for the first time after that, I had some gelato. Game over.
Well, actually, sorry, I will then mention the fact that we do have a partnership with not with Gonzaga University, sadly, but with Florence University of the Arts. And students in the Italian major or minor, but students of all paths and majors can spend either a month in the summer or a whole semester in Florence studying whatever they desire. Of course, there's a focus on Italian language and or literature and or culture. Famous and fabled are the sommelier and wine tasting classes, but one does not necessarily has to follow that. But the point is that if you wanted to get to meet Professor Houston in person, you could elect to spend a semester in Florence, and then I'm sure that he'll be happy to meet with you and coffee and discuss Canto 25 or 26.
Or whatever, yeah. Or whatever. Gelato as well. And I can show you the many monuments to Dante here, including the statue where his name is misspelled. The Florentines are really, really bad about Dante. They really don't treat him as well as they should.
Thank you both. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Dan. I think we have reached our time limit, and I think that we will need to stop. But in the meanwhile, I would like to, or before closing, I would like to renew my thanks to Professor Houston. Thank you very much. It's if I may, Jason. It's great to see you.
Nice
and
to see
I'm
you.
Sorry yeah. that yeah. The pandemic has prevented us from doing skiing, this in person.
Other things.
But I'm sure that it will happen soon enough.
And I really renew my thanks to you all for listening to me, for reading Dante with me. It's a pleasure to teach Dante every time, even on Zoom, even with students who aren't my own. So I was nervous before this because every time I teach Dante, I get nervous because I want to do justice to the poetry. So I hope I did. I hope you learned something. And buona lettura. You've got a great road ahead of you all if you continue to read Dante and other things. And try Boccaccio as well. He's fun too.
Thank you.
Ciao, ragazzi.
Ciao.